leadership. I will tell you that Republicans are just smiling with glee if they can make it their shot now to be in charge. I'm going to tell you, if you're going to be in charge, you better learn how to govern. You can't just sit there and be, you know, okay, now we're in the majority. Because being in the majority comes with responsibility. And I think I've proven that at the state capitol. I haven't made all the right choices, but I've made some tough ones. And if you're going to be in leadership, like the mayor has, you got to make tough choices. Doesn't mean everybody's going to like it. And at the end of the day, sometimes at the end, 49 percent that don't like you, you might be in good shape. But, you know, we have to make tough choices. And everyone's not always going to be on the same page. But if the Republicans are going to take back the Senate and have their eyes on the White House, they better understand that this nation needs help. One of the reasons in 2012 that I believe Governor Romney did not win was because the Republicans had Obamacare and the Republicans had Medicaid Obamacare. I think Obamacare is crushing our nation. I think it is crushing rural Arizona. But we have to have solutions that will also be helpful. And we can't just say no. So that's what I'm talking about when you know, we're going to go back there and lead, you better lead. And when folks came to me and said, gosh, it's now 8 years ago, you guys remember when I was first running for office. I got in the race very late. There were already three people in a race for two half seats. And I got in very late. My first sign went up the day they mailed ballots out. I went around putting up signs, you know, and I won by 42 votes on election night. 2 years later, I was in charge of it, and I became Speaker of the House. And I promise you, I made a difference. Then we cut your taxes. And you cut your taxes so that we can get reelected. You cut your taxes so we can be more competitive. And then we started putting money back into the highway funds that the cities and the counties have been struggling with for a decade, not getting their growth. It's not enough. We still need more. If you come up to where I live by Holden, you know where this is, the Hell's Canyon is up there. There's a wall, and that's where it's the size of this open. That shuts off commerce to you know, North Prescott in the Yavapai County. It's the only way in and out from I-40. It's just the only way to get there. So think about that for a moment. Our roads are in trouble. Our infrastructure needs help. So we finally had a chance to start putting those dollars back to where they belong. And went back in the J-6, back in the community colleges, back in our K-12 system, back in our universities, but also, so that's our workforce development. But also it's got to get back into infrastructure. And those pieces will help Arizona better recover. Because when that business suddenly finds out one day, gosh, it's worth taking a risk to come here with Marana and bring 500 employees with us, they're going to want to make that decision because they know that these folks invested in their infrastructure. They're ready with their schools. They know that their employees will be happy here. And they will have a quality of life. And that's what Arizona is all about. And those are the things that I bring to the table. And, so it's been a rough ride, but our country's still in trouble. And I think somebody that's been in the trenches, somebody that gets it, somebody that's not afraid to stand up for the issues that are important to rural Arizona first, and not to a party, but to what we believe in, I think I've earned your vote. That's when I think what we're doing here in our country will start turning the tide so that when we're done, I can look back and say, you know what, Dad? I gave back a better country. And I don't feel that's the way right now. So that's the reason I'm in it. As you said, it's all about sincerity. And, you know, those who serve in public office and help others who serve in public office, I thank you for what you're doing because it's not easy. You know, you don't make a hell of a living at it. But we believe in community service. And I think that's many of our families grew up that way. I ended up in as President of the United States, J.C.'s, and what did we do? Service to humanity is the best work of life. Raise money for MVA and for St. Jude's and for our own local hospitals. That's who we are. So they can just send somebody who you are back to Washington. Somebody that doesn't want to stay there forever. Somebody who wants to go back and fix it, come back home. We'd like to hear better. So I thought I'd open it up for some questions. Thanks. Good to see you. Anybody have any thoughts?
Well, you brought up Obamacare. What are your thoughts for?
Yeah.
either saying no, if that didn't sound like that's what you were saying. So what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, Obamacare missed all the testimonies. And I'll share with you. The one point that they have on the pre-existing condition, you're always fighting and struggling. So I think that that's something that stays. But if you look at what drives the cost of health care, we did not solve that problem. What they did was they cut Medicare to help pay for it. Now we have, especially rural physicians, who are dealing with a lot of Medicare patients struggling to be able to, struggling to be able to get compensated for their work. And that's a problem. I believe there's five categories that the federal government can help us with. It's cancer, it's heart, it's diabetes, it's transplants, and especially transplants. And then there's some conversation we need to have about living wills and also prescriptions. Those are the five drivers. So if you see the Medicare model, you know, they have A coverage and B coverage, you know, A is for hospitalization, B is for the doctor. You know, they set, it really is a pretty decent model. So if you can imagine for a moment that what we invest in is economies of scale for those factors where we can take the pressure off of the diabetes community by having better resources and better strategy and investment in technology that can reduce those costs. I think that helps drive down the costs. Right now, and I'm in this business, so I do group insurance for companies and small business. I do their health care. So I'm the one who's watching these drivers. So you can have a group of five people, and if one of them gets sick with a cancer, their rate comes sky high. Remember that. That's how it works. There's only so many people here, your rates are going to go. But if we can find a way where we can help the small business owners and large business owners, where we can better invest in the technologies that are going to actually help them drive down the costs and use the economies of scale so that we can work. You can have a physician here in Marana who can maybe be diagnosing someone with a cancer and depressing. Or you can have a heart surgeon down here who can be talking to somebody in Sholo and reading back to them what their consult or what their MRI says. Those are the things that I think will help us drive down the cost where we can have better technologies that can get us there. Right now, I mean, if we're watching, even if you go back to the Navajo Nation, they are so buried in with the diabetes, the cost of diabetes, it's so difficult for them. You know, here every once in a while you might see the diabetes bus come around and there's a testing for folks. We can't get that to places that need it, especially in the U.S. Could you imagine if we were able to drive some of those resources, drive some of those, not even just technology, but information that can help those people with their diets and things, prolong lives, reduce the cost overall. And more importantly, if you're driving down the cost of healthcare coverage, it's not, let's face it, it's not the office visits of Dr. Moyer or Dr. Schmidt or Dr. Bill that's driving these costs up for us. You know, having the health savings accounts really were starting to work. And when they said the health savings accounts is a larger deductible, but you're going to have your annual exam covered at 100%, that was successful. And it still should be. Because people could then know that they can get their annual cost, their annual exams covered. And if you start getting folks on that kind of a regimen where they're looking out ahead of the curve, that will help drive costs down. But right now what we have this game going on where we continue to cut Medicare doctors who then are saying, okay, well, where do I get my money from if you're going to cut me more? So they want to raise their costs to the commercial market. The commercial markets raise their costs to the business community. The business community then raises their costs to their employees and their families. And you might have noticed that this hasn't driven, this new national health care has not driven the cost of health care down. So what we did was we took the best health care system, the best technologies in the world, and we shuffled it all up into a bureaucracy which is now spending more money and taxing us more, rather than letting the private sector have a better plan going forward. And I think that better plan is pooling
for big issues. So insurance costs then?
Yeah. I do fall away from my party when they say, well, let's do insurance over state lines. That's fine. I'll vote for it. But I will tell you that I don't see how that works. let's say Kelly is, Kelly Insurance in Indiana is going to come into Arizona because now he can cross state lines. Kelly Insurance is going to come to Arizona and say to you know, Honey Hospital, hey, guess what? We're here. We want you to give us a good price so that you can be our network hospital. Well, why would Hans Hospital give a better price to Kelly in Indiana than they're giving to, you know, Blue Cross Arizona? They don't. They don't. So I get it. It sounds good, like we'll have more competition, which I think is always good. But when you're talking about managed care, wherever that insurance network is in Florida or New York, they're going to have to come in here and talk to Dr. Schmidt, the local podiatrist, or the local gynecologist, or whoever they might be, and get a good discounted rate to provide a network. I don't think they get a better rate than what these doctors and physicians and hospitals can afford to give now to the local insurance company. So I don't have a problem with crossing state lines. I just think I just know it's not going to save us the money that they think it's going to save us. But I believe if you start pooling, we're insurance companies, and especially some of the groupings that you have, we're self-funded companies, self-funded employers, cities, counties, some of the larger employers, where they can buy into a diabetes network, where they can say, here's the diabetes plan. You know, so if one of your employees comes down with diabetes, it comes down with heart issues, and this is the place where we can get our best bang for our buck. Where you've got the best who are in these pools who can then help them all. So I think that those are things that we should be looking at. But taking that over in a government that's already $17 trillion in debt, and especially after this rollout that we've seen, and after what I'm now seeing with rates continuing to rise, I think was a fool's errand. I think the part about having pre-existing peace, it was good because we have to find a place where that will work. I agree that if someone doesn't have insurance, they're going to walk in the hospital, and we're all going to pay that price. What's going on now is that someone who didn't have insurance that walks in the hospital now with it, guess what? We're all paying that price because we're paying the bill anyway.
Hopefully, though, they're going to their doctor rather than
That's the key, that they can get their health.
Sorry, urgent care. Those that have popped up really do lower the cost a lot.
Absolutely. And the drivers for the emergency room go for that.
Right.
We have our community health centers. A lot of them in the rural Arizona take a lot of that pressure off. But you're exactly right. If we have a place where, guess what, you can go and get your mammogram, you can go and get your MRI. That helps us in the long run. But right now, if you remember when Obamacare first came out, they were actually making mammograms later in life, thinking that's where there was a savings. And until the women of America started screaming, that didn't change.
Mm-hmm.
And when they heard of it, it started changing. But it was, if you think about what their tactic was, they were trying to find, well, how do we save money? Well, let's save the mammograms when they're 50 instead of 40. Well, I'll talk to my wife about that, because she's got friends who were, you know, who ended up with breast cancer, and it wasn't...
Before 40. So it's hard, yeah.
Right. Hard. So the truth is that we have a system that's out of control because of our costs. The cost drivers are where we need to concentrate on. And I think we should be able to do that. If you look at the transplant costs, I mean, it's astronomical for a transplant. God forbid, you know, some family has to go through that. But isn't there a better way if we have several hospitals working together in a pooling system that says, well, let's bring our best transplant surgeons together amongst ourselves. Let's find the best technologies that work here. And maybe we need to, you know, adopt some of the efficiencies from Indiana or New York. Or maybe they want to adopt some from Arizona. Remember, I can remember in my lifetime as a young person, everyone came to U of A for heart transplants. Do you remember that? This was the place the world came and that expanded. So I think there's ways that we can use technologies and infrastructure, but also communication to make sure that we're able to have some economies of scale in those issues that are driving the cost of healthcare. Because it's not that group of 10 who don't have any of those issues. It's that group of 10 who has a diabetic and a cancer, you know. So I think the cost to young families to be able to afford healthcare is out of control. I pay more now on my healthcare than I pay for my first mortgage. You think about that. You wonder know, they just talk about, you know, people say, well, we need to raise minimum wage, and I'm like, maybe what you need to do is get healthcare down, maybe we need to get gas prices down, maybe we need to, you know, move it in a direction that's helping with it. If you haven't noticed the cost of beef lately, the prices are going up in our stores. It's all relative to a lot of the gas prices and an inflationary trend that we're starting to experience. Thank you for that. I mean, those are good questions. But again, back to your point, Republicans just can't say no. They have to say, what's the next idea? Why don't we get Mayo Clinic in here with Banner and let's have a conversation. Let's listen to them. See what their drivers are. See what they think they can do to help us. I think those are the answers. I mean, the people at the table that can help you find those better options. What do you think of that? So listen, the campaign is going very well. A year ago, I didn't know I was going to be here. My legislative district includes Yarnell. So we had a fire last year, which is an anniversary is coming up. So all through July, we had that to deal with and ongoing, obviously. So right around the end of the summer, you know, I feel started talking to me about getting into this race. And I toured the district because I knew so many people. We've been endorsed by over 30 mayors, city council, and then county supervisors, sheriffs, in the district itself. And yet at the same time, we think that this district is not just winnable for Republicans, but certainly winnable for me because of my relationship with public safety, fire, and business. The United States Chamber of Commerce actually endorsed me. They haven't done this in Arizona, I don't think ever, especially early in the fundraising. Governor Romney came out to be with me and helped do the fundraising for us. You know, Governor Romney won this congressional district when he ran here for president. And so did Jeff Flake. Senator Kyle's been helping me. We just feel very blessed that we've had so much support. And I think that our conversation is resonating. People want to see a vision. They want to know where your heart is. And I think that's really my best suit. So I really thank you for coming out and spending some time with me. You know, it's important that as I move on, that I ask you to be forthright. Certainly say some prayers because there's a lot of miles out there, and we all know that. And I think that, you know, circulating information about me at dandytobin.com. And doing these group meetings helps me because it helps me get the sense of what this community's needs are, what their concerns have been. So you don't have to be far from Boston and Prescott to know their concern is that VA hospital. You don't have to be far from the Phoenix one either to know that that's their concern. You don't have to be far from Sackler when you worry about water in their contracts. And you don't have to be far from Marana when we talk about our economy, our infrastructure, and our schools. And I think that I share that language, and I share those concerns, and I think we've got a great opportunity to not just bring Arizona back in this congressional district, but also send a message in Washington that people in Arizona know how to pull themselves up by their own bootstraps, or are working people, and we think that this is something that you can learn from us. So anyway, so I thank you for spending some time. Thank you, Mayor. Appreciate it. Good. Thank you, sir. Good. I know I have another big event I think
there's a commitment to make sure our children are protected, make sure our children, you know, are getting the services that they need, and especially abused children, and actually fighting child pornography, all in the same place. And I've been down to the legislature, this is my eighth year. We had everybody vote on it. Everybody was a yes. You don't often find everybody voting in the same direction, but this was that important. Now, if we had known anything about this going on before we passed that, we might have been able to say, hey, we need to put something in here for what about children crossing the border? So we just passed this 3 weeks ago, and nobody said a word. When I contacted the governor, I said, do you have any idea this was coming? Nobody knew. Mayor didn't know. I mean, how do you do that to a state and say, by the way, we're sending a bunch of folks over to your bus stations, and by the way, we're bringing them in here. And I pick up the phone, even a courtesy call, and say, guess what? You know, this is coming. It never happened. So, you know, without mean the conspiracy theory, you start thinking, you know, well, why?
Yeah.
I mean, if Ed was going to say, hey, you know, I got, you know, 200 cars coming from Marana, we're going to put them up in Poland next week, he'd at least have called me and told me so I could have prepared for that. You know, I mean, it's not, it seems like there's so many missing parts of this story that you never seem to get all the story anyway.
So do you think because, like, unlike the Texas or California, Arizona is very, not very crowded a state, they think that you can just take these people, or?
No, I just think that we were selected because they knew they had a facility. They probably rubbing it in, you know, my nose at the street of the house. And, you know, we did 1070, we did e-verify. I will tell you that having gone down to Mexico City and trying to build some corporate investment from there into Arizona, we talk about these, you know, about these bills. We talk about 1070. We talk about e-verify. They don't worry so much there about 1070. They don't like e-verify because that's about the business community. And they're right. I had a harder time with that one because I didn't think the federal government should be pushing immigration detection on our businesses and costing, you know, businesses money. And they felt the same way. So, you know, when they were doing it to maybe poke Arizona in the eye a little bit, I wouldn't be surprised. Again, disappointed, but I wouldn't be the least bit surprised.
So they have this 200,000 square foot facility for what in the house?
Well,
are they going to grow?
FEMA is actively, now FEMA is part of this process. So,
FEMA's in the midst of
it. FEMA's there, you know, Homeland Security, I mean, so the whole point's bullet. Well, I think that they were bringing trucks in when we were down there, where they just got them there, and they were shower trucks, and there were like six of those that were coming in, and then they actually had a laundry truck. So you almost had the sense like, okay, Katrina just happened, we're coming here, but this is different, this is children. You know, but FEMA was actively involved in that process. So, sir.
I'm Jack Camber. I've been trying to get together with you for some time. Played a little tough on tag, but I've got a different subject on my mind here tonight. If you've already covered it, I got here a little late. Got lost in there.
GPS, Jack.
I had my GPS, but it wouldn't let me put 8881 in there. So I drove right on by. But at any rate, and I got to the stop sign up there, and I had to turn left and right. I turned around and came back. But at any rate, as we have, in my opinion, a very interesting potential crisis in the Tucson metropolitan area, and that's this business with the A-10 and Davis Mountain Air Force Base. I don't know if that base is in your district. I don't think so.
Well, it's not my district, but the A-10 affects all of Arizona.
Very, very important, and I think that we've probably made a few mistakes along the way by not looking for another mission. If the airport force doesn't want the A-10,
right,
why do we want to force them to have a plane that they don't think they ought to have?
Yeah.
And we should have been looking for other missions all along.
It's not just any because you've been successful at the league or at the legislature or even now. And, you know, we don't need an absentee congressman.
Right. Yeah.
You know, I'll say one thing for Gabby Giffords. She used to call me about once every 2 months. Hi, Mayor, how you doing? Anything I can do to help Marana? You know, things going on. I'm going to be in town such and such a day. I'd like to see you. Not once is in perfection.
You know, that's a...
Not one time.
I've had, I've been surprised by a bunch of sheriffs.
Doesn't surprise me.
Yeah.
Well, she doesn't think she needs Southern Arizona.
Well,
she thinks she can get it done on a nation and in Northern Arizona.
What happened on the campaign before was working with Jonathan Bate,
right?
We went to bed with Jonathan with a 5,000 point lead because most of the votes had come in down here. You're going to win down here.
Right. Yep.
You got to get some votes out of that Flagstaff and the Native American community.
Absolutely. We're real lucky in that way. You know, I served in the legislature and served Flagstaff for 6 years. So I'm not someone who, and Jonathan, God bless him, because I can't pay for him in Flagstaff where he needs help. But they know me. I've won 6 elections in Coconino County over the last 8 years. So I have name ID there. They know who I am. We have a Republican mayor there. Their neighbors now is up there. You should have heard these mayors up
upset, and myself, chiming in too, when they closed our parks. And on days when we were trying to pass continuing resolutions to at least keep the parks open, you know, listen to the mayors and Tucson and Williams and Page and Flagstaff and others, because while they were shutting down their parks, everyone here knew it was about Arizona. People, you know, come to the Grand Canyon to see it. But then they come this way, just back, and then they go that way. And they
spend a lot of money.
They spend a lot of money. And Kirkpatrick was fine with them closing down the parks. And that is a real stretch for me. And I mean, the Grand Canyon, the Tucson's less than an hour from our house, so, you know, to the Grand Canyon. So, I mean, we know the impact that that has on Arizona and certainly the region. You know, and, you know, people were, hotels were canceling. The mayor up there was the manager of the hotel, Best Western. You know, when you have five people left in the hotel and two of them were your employees, you got a problem. Mm-hmm. And that was a problem. So I think that, you know, I think we just have to, you know, lock our arms together and have some folks who are willing to serve. I enjoy doing this. I know that sounds odd. My wife thinks I'm crazy, probably. But I enjoy coming out and listening and communicating. Today, just on our way down, I'm making calls, talking to sheriffs to give them updates on what I got, you know, that I just gave you, quite frankly, from down in Nogales. And you're like, wow, thanks for the update. You know, Sheriff Sheehan in Mojave, Sheriff McMaster in Yucca Pike County, BJ Allred over here, Sheriff Babu, we may or may not see later. But I mean, they, you know, what's going on down there? What can you tell me? You know, you have cops at risk. Mm-hmm. They are, law enforcement is trying to get information and know what's going on. So I learned that from my dad, who's a retired lieutenant in the New York City Police Department. Always go with it. I'll watch out for those guys. But you're getting a great point. I think folks just want to know that they know what's important in the district, but they know what's important in each town. And if you're going to run for Congress in a district as large as this one, you better know how to run for mayor. Because every one of those elections, you're not going to buy a TV ad in Congressional District 1 and say, okay, I'm done. I don't work for him last time. But, you know, the mayors want to see you. City council people want to see you, the business community wants to see you, and when you walk into the town, you better know that what's important here in Winslow isn't that you're sitting on the corner in Winslow, Arizona. They want to know what's going on with Coronado. They want to know what's going on, what are those jobs looking like. When you go to the Holbrook, they want to know what's happening with the potash opportunities in our mining community. They want to know that. When you go into Page, they want to know, goodness gracious, we had, you know, they talk about roadways. You remember Paige had that landslide and took out me? And I think what we need some leadership that talks about America's aspiration, about how great we are. And, you know, when we talk about the greatest generation who's now leading us, I will share with you, and I tell this wherever I go, because I go campaign and meet kids in community colleges and everything. These kids, think for a moment what our greatest generation did. They left here to go to places to fight for people they never met, lands they never met. And our children are doing the same thing right now. Except the difference is that back then they had a president who was on their side and carried a flag with them. And this time, these folks aren't sure where the president's at. And I don't think you can contemplate sending these kids into war, these kids into battlefields, when you're not sure the president's committed to their welfare. So I would share with you, there's room to make budget reductions without the world thinking that Arizona is going to reduce its power and we're going to stop being who we are. I think most of you would agree, America is about spirit and heart. Who fights for freedom like we do? Who fights for other people's freedom like we do? And I think our enemies want the world to know that we won't do that anymore. And we're less of a nation for it if they succeed.
We have a person who doesn't care.
Yeah, well, there's... Well, I'm starting actually believing that. I get in trouble with the press when I say this thing, but the truth is that I can't keep up with the amount of scandals going on and the amount of catastrophes going on in Washington anymore. It wasn't so long ago, I was screaming about Fast and Furious. You've hardly heard a word about that, but I think it wasn't so long ago, maybe just weeks, you finally got committees on Benghazi. And in that period of time, we've had the veteran scandal, we have the IRS problem, we have the missing emails. If I missed an email at the office, I'd be on the front page of the county here in every newspaper.
much that's distracting us from our mission of growing our economy and getting our country back to work.